Well, good morning. We want to welcome you to Riverlawn Presbyterian Church. I'm Pastor Chris Kilbert. We're glad that you have joined us this morning. If you're worshiping with us virtually, welcome. We're glad you're tuning in. A few things we want to mention as we get started. This is Super Bowl of Caring Sunday. A lot of the non-perishables that have been donated are up front. There's also some in the gym, and we want to say thank you to those who donated that food. It'll certainly be used. The youth group was, or family night kids were able to go to the pantry on Wednesday and just learn the many ways that the food and other things are able to be of help. So that was a great experience for them too. Also, we want to say thank you to those who've brought the donations for the hero baskets. Those are going to be assembled today. And then also after church, our youth are invited, and also anyone really. Alan Resick from the pantry will be coming, and we'll be able to load up the food for it to go there. Are there other announcements? Joe.
Good morning. I just wanted to make a quick announcement. The Personnel Committee has been reconvened, and we are seeking a child care worker for our Sunday mornings and for Wednesday evenings. It'd be about 2 hours at each time, and we need somebody who is at least 18 years old, preferably not a member of the church, and the reason for that being is so that the members can participate in our services. They have to be 18 or older, and they have to pass a background check. If y'all put the word out and know anybody that might be interested in that, back in years ago, we had one. In fact, it was an older lady. You know, it's age is not a problem as long as they're over 18. And if you would know of anyone or be interested in that, you can have them or you contact myself, Jamie Albert, Ann Cox, or Barb Wilson, and we'll get the process started. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Joe. Are there other announcements? All right, let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
Church, let's stand and sing together, "We Have Come Into His House." Would you please pray with me? Lord, we've sung it, "It is our desire," but we also confess that often we have it backwards. That too often we magnify ourselves and we forget about you. And so we confess, Lord. We repent. Lord, we pray that you give us strength to desire you above all. Forgive us when we have bowed to the things of this world. Lord, fill us with a passion to desire you and to do your work so that all of our life and all of this world bows to you. May it begin with us. Let us take the next few moments to silently confess our sins and bow our hearts to the Lord. And we pray this in the powerful name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. Hear the good news from Romans chapter 13, beginning in verse 11. Our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, for he is your righteousness. This is the good news of the gospel. Thanks be to God. Thank you. Thank you, Pam, and thank you, choir. If you haven't already, we want to let you know that our elementary age children are dismissed to junior church. Now we turn to God's Word. We come to maybe a familiar passage, certainly a familiar passage to our family night kids. We've been spending some time in Micah chapter 6. This is also, if you didn't know, the theme verse of the Super Bowl of Caring, S-O-U-P-E-R, always on Super Bowl Sunday, started in a Presbyterian church several decades ago. It's grown to be a movement that seeks to respond with the love of Jesus Christ with those who are in need. And our passage certainly speaks to that. So let's hear the word of the Lord from Micah 6, beginning in verse 6. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. The word of the Lord. Would you please pray with me? Lord, teach us, show us, convict us, illumine us to what it means to act justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with you in this world, in the place you've called us for your glory. We pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. So Andy was an interesting fellow. He had a pretty good, the choir's not back there anymore, by the way. I try to be intentional, and sometimes it backfires. So Andy was had a pretty good sense of humor. He, sometimes people thought he was a little quirky, but he was known to say a few different phrases that were very true. And he was known to always come up to you and say, just remember, Jesus loves me, and Jesus loves you. Always a good thing for us to know, whether we're children or adults. Every once in a while, like the rest of us, he'd get a little annoyed, maybe a little irritated, and he would change it up a little to say, you know, remember, Jesus loves me, and he likes you. But when things really got bad, he would just throw his hands up in the air, look up in the heavens and say, God, what do you want from me? What do you want from me? And have you ever been there, whether you've done it with your hands and said it audibly or not, but have you felt like doing that, just pleading with God, God, what do you want from me? You know, it's interesting. It just so happens that that's the message that Micah offers us today. Micah was the prophet of the downtrodden and the exploited of Judah. He prophesied during a time of great injustice. He boldly opposed those who used their power to take advantage of the poor for selfish ends. It's not surprising that the prophets were often unpopular to the culture of that day, to those in power of that day, why some of these prophets were often executed for it, because they opposed that. And so as he preaches to the people, Micah raises the same question. God Almighty, what do you want from me? But Micah does a little bit more poetic than Andy. What does the Lord require of us? And then we are given a very brief threefold response. But there's a ton to unpack in that every day, to think about thoughtfully, intentionally, proactively. But let's consider these three responses. First, we're called to act justly or to do justice in some translations. In other words, we're to act with fairness and integrity. As I was thinking about this, I mean, just memories of Biddy Basketball kind of just flowed over me, because there's so many things that we try to just teach these children about what does it mean to act fairly and to be kind. And you know what? On one level, it should be elementary to us. But as we get exposed and saturated by this world, we may start to rationalize or justify and not look at justice the same way we try to teach our children to do so. But Micah had a very special concern for justice, because, frankly, he saw so little of it. That what God requires of us is that we do right in our relationships with one another. To forget about ourselves and not pursue our own end at the expense of others. Justice involves a standard of equality among others. And I think everyone would affirm that's a good thing. But do our actions and our thoughts, our behaviors reflect that? It can be as simple as being honest in the smallest routine transaction, whether it's a financial transaction or not, all kinds of ways that we interact and engage with others. There's an old saying, honesty is the best policy. Well, for the Christian, it should be the only policy. It should be the only thing. There is this consistent theme in all the scripture that we are called to be a people of integrity in all of our dealings. Psalm 51:6, I think, puts it in a very helpful way, a challenging way to us. It's a prayer, actually. The psalmist prays, Lord, you desire truth in the inner parts. It's not just an awareness. It's a prayer that that might be the case. It's a pursuit in life to do so. So we must settle it deep in our hearts to be a people of integrity, and that will mean to be on our guard in this battle of a fallen world to act justly. It's a very intentional thing. We have to examine our life. And sometimes it'll be hard when we come face to face in ways that we haven't. And the fact is, scandals happen every day, but most do the cheating on the small scales that never make the headlines and maybe are never known to anyone else in this life. But the Lord knows. We talked about a lot of that in Sunday school this morning. And that should be more than enough for us. And yet we cheat our coworker, and we deceive the neighbor, and we swindle the stranger. But what do we hear again and again that God requires of all of us, whether we're a super business or a single individual, to act justly, to do justice? That's proactive. It's not just not doing injustice. It's making sure that we're promoting what God has told us is right and true. Because he's the definer of it. So that's the first one, to act justly. The second we're going to spend most of our time on, and that is to love mercy. Those two words, my favorite of this verse. The word translated as mercy, I don't try to say too many Hebrew or Greek words, but this one is probably my favorite, hesed. Hesed, which is translated a number of different things. It's a rich one, communicating things that you probably heard: loving kindness, steadfast love. And it's important to first consider it in relation to God's hesed, God's mercy. And this is such a difficult word to unpack. It's so full of meaning. But this is best I could come up with. It refers to his unexpected, undeserved, unbroken, unwavering, unending kindness toward us. So ponder those two words, love, mercy. Micah is not just telling us, like he did with act justly, he's not only telling us to demonstrate mercy or to practice mercy, he tells us that we're to fall in love with mercy. Seems appropriate on a Valentine's Day weekend. What do we really want to pursue? And this is going to apply to all of us. To fall in love with mercy. The wide biblical concept of mercy most certainly involves forgiveness. I think that's at the heart of it. You hear Jesus' parables, his life, his call upon us, what it means to be a follower. It's central that we demonstrate the forgiveness of the Father for to be those sons and daughters reflecting our Father in heaven. But there's something else to this word. This wondrous word also has to do with loyalty, particularly God's loyalty, his faithfulness, his unending, unbroken faithfulness. One commentator put it this way: this steady, persistent refusal of God to wash his hands of his wayward people is the essential meaning of the Hebrew word that is translated loving kindness or mercy. If you want to accuse God of being stubborn in anything, it's his refusal not to forgive us, his refusal not to abandon us, that he is loyal even when we're not. He is faithful even when we're not. That's what's at the heart of this word, mercy. This is a loyalty and love that is seasoned with graciousness and forgiveness, particularly to those who do not deserve it, and that's everyone. It's every single one of us. And so it is one of the most beautiful words in any language, including our English language, and certainly one of the most precious truths of the Christian faith. Mercy. So what does it mean to fall in love with mercy? It means that having received mercy ourselves from God, that I am to walk in assurance, I am to walk with thankfulness, using this gift of mercy that I have received as the lens through which I view anyone else's sin. Think about that. That how we look and treat and respond to others should always be filtered through how God has treated us. That's profound. We take it for granted. I think we understand it and we believe it, but are we functioning that way through the power of the Spirit? The lens through which we treat others. We've heard it, there's a number of scriptures. Forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. Be merciful as you have been shown mercy. Mercy truly is wonderful, because without mercy, again, we talked a little bit about this in Sunday school, I'd be lost forever without mercy. That through his mercy, God has made a way for me to experience eternal joy instead of eternal separation. Mercy, hesed, steadfast love and faithfulness. That God is stubborn. He won't abandon us because he loves us. Mercy. The wonderful thing is it's not only God displaying it to us. He wants us to model it. So mercy also allows me to minister. So as one who fails daily, I could not even begin to embody the gospel unless every day I joyfully trusted in the knowledge that my Savior's sacrifice on my behalf has redeemed and restored me. That's what it's about. Gary Thomas puts it really well. Without mercy, I'd be toast. But with mercy, the celebratory toast never ends. That we get to rejoice in the wonder of his mercy. So love mercy. And so falling in love with mercy means that I love everything about it, that there's no arena in my life where I don't delight in mercy. The people who love mercy feel eager to show mercy to others. That like God, you don't have to convince these people to show mercy, that they love to show mercy. A Christian who understands mercy is someone who looks forward to another opportunity to demonstrate God's grace. To model it, to pursue reconciliation rather than revenge. That's the ministry that has been entrusted to us. This is what the kingdom of God is about. This is what the gospel is about. It is embodying who Christ is and what he has offered us. And it's true, by default, by nature, there's plenty of instances where our first instinct is not to be merciful. There's often very other things. But we can't forget what we need ourselves. That you and I are imperfect, fallible, prone to mess up, sinners saved by mercy. That our sin and guilt are so powerful that absent of mercy, every human relationship will fail. Every single one. Now, it's true. You can self-righteously judge every person who has ever lived. You can prove his or her guilt in a court of law. You can compellingly state your case and clearly demonstrate how far they have fallen short. But the judgment you render will not kill the sin in their life. It will kill the love of mercy in yours. Too often we don't love mercy. We don't value kindness. When we should be gentle with others, we're harsh. We return rudeness for rudeness. And hopefully as adults, we know that that's wrong, even if it is our instinctive reaction. But I think we're also encountering in culture, whether it's for our children or our grandchildren or even as adults, where that's more than just acceptable, but it's expected. It's the thing that you should do. That somehow that's become virtuous. But by doing so, we allow opportunities to show kindness to pass us by. So where do we learn to love mercy? By observing and reflecting it in the life of our Savior Jesus Christ. That's the answer to it. Jesus modeled mercy all throughout his life. He displayed it even at his death. We talked about this in Sunday school last week. You know, you may want to come. You've seen I mentioned it a few times already. Thief on the cross is a beautiful proclamation on the depth of God's mercy. That the perfect Son of God, as he nears death, he comforts a sinner in his darkest hour who cannot do anything to make amends. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise. That's mercy. That's the definition of mercy. Often mercy is not what we would show to another, if we're honest. Would not be our first instinct or maybe even our preference, but it really is the only fitting response in light of the mercy that God has shown to you and me in Christ Jesus. So meditate on mercy. Just meditate on it. Too often we allow the lies of the enemy, the deceiver, to make us doubt who we are in our Savior Jesus Christ. Meditate on the mercy of God. Meditate on it throughout the scriptures. Know the truth. And when you do, you will fall in love with it. So seek to understand what a gift that you've been given in God's mercy. And then from that foundation, explore the riches of extending that same mercy to others. Love mercy. And finally, walk humbly with your God. When Micah tells us what the Lord expects of us, what does the Lord require of us? The first two things have to do with how we typically behave toward one another. One, God desires that we treat each other fairly, justly, with integrity. Second, he wants us to model him by loving mercy, showing kindness, again, embodying his nature. But then, this third expectation that Micah shares is that God desires for us to have a right relationship with him. It's like the grand finale. It's what it all wraps up into. You know, you think of Jesus offering, what's the greatest commandment? Love God with everything. Love your neighbor as yourself. You can't separate them. And Micah's doing the same thing here. And so how do we have a right relationship with God? Well, it begins, it always begins, it must begin with humility. It doesn't work without humility. But why should we walk humbly? Because of who we are and because of who we were. We're reminded of that throughout the letters of scriptures too. Remember who we were before we encountered the grace and mercy of God in Jesus Christ. This is how Paul says in Ephesians 2. Like the rest, like everyone, we're thrown in there. We were by nature, where we were, objects of wrath. We almost want to move right past those words. We don't want to think about ourselves as objects of wrath. Pretty strong words. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. We hear that. No wonder God expects us to walk humbly with him. Humble because of who we are without him. Humble because of who we now are in him. Humility, easy in theory. Just like acting justly and loving mercy. Easy in theory, hard to make a reality, because by nature we are prideful. It's at the root of it all. We tend to function as if it's God's job to make us happy, to answer our prayers in our timing and in our way, and we know that's not right. But we often function that way because we're people in need. And he loves us. He wants to meet those needs. But we need to think about why we come before him, who we now are in him. So to walk humbly means to wait upon the Lord. It means to listen for his leading, to serve where he sends, to praise his name forever. And so whenever we start getting puffed up with pride, and that takes on a lot of different dimensions, arrogance is not the only form. We can express pride in countless ways. But when God is so gracious by his Spirit to reveal that to us, we must fall upon his grace, his mercy, his gift. So, as we start to wrap up, how do these realities, to act justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with our God, how do they come together in the life of the Christ follower? I believe that Romans 13, we heard a couple verses from Romans 13 already, but verses 8 through 10 say it well. Listen to these words. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments are all summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Love fulfills the law. Love fulfills the charge of Micah 6:8. Love is a moral principle. To act justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly, those are moral principles. And that these principles, as principles, apply at all times, in all places. So we can never say, well, I don't really have to do justice, to act justly in this case because of X, Y, and Z. I don't have to show mercy to that person. They don't deserve it. Well, then it wouldn't be mercy. No. If we want to honor God's command, love must be enfleshed, just as it was with our Savior Jesus Christ. So when we love, we should not need to be reminded not to steal or to lie or to cheat. Paul says love does no harm to a neighbor. But the truth is, we who live in this hostile world still struggle with desires to make gains for ourselves while ignoring others. And that expresses itself in different ways, but it seems to come at us one way or the other. And so what we learn is that only the perfect love of Jesus Christ, showed when he gave his life for ours, is sufficient to fulfill the law. That to love as Jesus did means that by the power of the Spirit, we are to incorporate God's self-sacrificing love into our lives. That to love as Jesus did means we must do that. that in Christ, God showed us not only perfect obedience to the law, but perfect love. Only Christ fulfills this. Only Christ fully lives out that perfect law. And only in Christ will we. Let's pray. Lord God, forgive us. Forgive us when we have failed to act justly or to love mercy or to walk humbly with you. Forgive us when we have harmed our neighbor. Help us to truly love you and others, guiding us by your own perfect love shown to us through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. As we continue to worship, we want to continue to mention while we're not collecting the offering during the service, we still have opportunity to respond to the God who has been merciful and gracious to us by enfleshing that in our own lives. So we have that opportunity to give back to God, to model that love as an expression of our love and thanks and joy. As we continue also to worship, we come to a time where we can pray for one another. Wanted to ask if there are concerns that you would share with us. Joe.
Our next door neighbor, Denny Pauley, he had to have emergency bypass surgery this week. He had 3 bypasses. And the surgery went well, and my prayer is for his recovery to go as well as the surgery did, and he'd be restored to full health.
Did you say the name again?
Denny Pauley.
Thank you. We will. Are there others? Jason.
This is kind of a concern slash celebration. My mom brought up a friend, a little 12-year-old boy. He's a friend of our family, Peyton Williams, a few weeks ago, who has cancer. And I just wanted to give an update that he's being treated in Cincinnati. His tumor is now half the size as what it was. His grandma, I worked with her, and she sent me a text with the scan and everything, so that was great. But Peyton's doing really well. He's getting to stay at the Ronald McDonald House with his mom some, and he even recently got to come home for a weekend visit. So he really enjoyed that. So if you all can just keep him in your prayers.
Thank you, Jason. You will. Are there others? We want to continue to lift up a few other individuals. We want to continue to pray for J.B. Recknagel and the Recknagel family. We want to be praying for Erin Roberts, who is recovering from her surgery. Last I heard, she's doing pretty good. Good. We continue to pray for her healing. Also, Sandra Cottle, who is in the hospital at Cabell Huntington. Know that her daughter Kim covets your prayers for her mother. We want to be praying for the Pettit family. Pete Pettit, who was the son of Ralph and Matt Pettit, Pete passed away. So we want to be praying for Pete's son Tim and their family in their time of grief, and that the peace and hope of the Holy Spirit be with them in this time. Are there other prayer concerns? Are there joys? Becky.
During a wonderful evening last night with close friends to celebrate Pat's, I'm going to say it, 60th birthday.
All right. Happy birthday, Pat. Belated. And it's also another one of our tech guys in the back. Paul O'Dell's birthday is today. So if we have that chance, let's wish Paula a happy birthday. Sorry, who raised your hand?
I would just like to say what a blessing it is to have our choir back this morning.
Yes, absolutely.
And they sounded wonderful, and just really enrich our worship. And I also want to thank Pam for hanging in there all this whole time and providing us with wonderful music all during our unfortunate incarceration.
She's smiling. She appreciates that. Are there others? Jim.
I want to say we heard from JB yesterday. Matter of fact, we talked to him twice. They were very emotional calls. I mean, he was quite upset that he hadn't called us, but he said he wasn't able to. And he just wanted us to know where he was at and that he was okay. You know, we were talking to our son. And he called again this morning and said he wants to talk to us every day. So, and I mean, he's thinking about things that show a certain level of clarity in his thinking. And I mean, that is so heartening, you know, to hear. And, you know, just like things about contacting SSI and letting them know that he's in the hospital. So, I mean, God's good. He's so good.
Thank you, Jim and Barb. We're glad for those opportunities that you've been able to talk with him. I know that is precious to you. We continue to be praying. Are there others? Well, let's pray together. Lord, as we come before you, we have heard of many needs, many different kinds of needs, many hurts, many forms of pain. Lord, we come before the only one who can work powerfully, eternally, redemptively. So, Lord, we pray that we may turn to you, cling to you, fall into your arms. Lord, we pray in the midst of this need that you will grant us once again the gift of your mercy, your loving kindness and steadfast love, your gracious loyalty. Lord, we pray that that will ever be felt, that that will strengthen and encourage, and that it'll also empower us to share it with others in their need. Lord, we pray that we can do that close to home, those in our midst. To others, you give us the grace to encounter. And Lord, around this world where there are Christians who are threatened, who are suffering, who are grieving, because of their faith in you. And so, Lord, we pray that your love and mercy be enfleshed, that all will see Christ, believe, and glorify you. And Lord, in the midst of our need, in the midst of our brokenness, in the midst of even darkness, Lord, we pray that we will always remember the assurance, the living hope that we have in our Savior Jesus. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. Help us to be like you. And we pray all these things in the name of the one who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Let's stand and sing together, "Open My Eyes That I May See," verses 1 and 3. We want to again thank you for worshiping with us. It is a joy to have you with us and hope to see you again soon. We have fellowship following the service in the gym. For those worshiping with us virtually, again, thank you. We hope to have opportunities to connect more. If you have a need of prayer, if there's something you heard today, you have questions about or want to talk about more, if you want to encounter the enfleshed love of God, We can pursue that together, and to know that he's offered that to us. Just a couple things I will mention as we leave. After the service, we'll be moving the canned goods as the pantry comes to collect those. If you're able to stay, if you're able to help, that's great. But also for our postlude, it is Micah 6:8. It's a song. And it's been a favorite for family night. The kids should be able to sing it well if they're hearing it through the speakers. I hope they join in. But as we hear this, I hope that you'll sing along and it'd be a prayer and a commitment. So Micah 6:8. And before we do that, I offer this benediction from Romans 13. Again, Romans 13. You heard this verse already. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. And may the peace of Christ be with you. Amen.